Here in Devon, in the tranquil Tamar Valley, is a port that once bustled with industry. Overground, farmers supplied Britain's growing towns and cities with fresh produce.
Step the hills, step to London.
While underground, miners extracted copper and precious minerals.
Wandering!
Now at Morwell and Quay, archaeologists Alex Langland and Peter Ginn and historian Ruth Goodman are going back in time to the early 1900s to live the lives of Edwardian farmers for a full calendar year. They'll not just be farming, but getting to grips with the rural industries that once brought wealth to Devon.
Oh wow! It's on something!
So far, the team's endeavours have laid the foundations of a working Edwardian farm.
Look at that, gorgeous!
They've brought in new livestock.
Be good to get some new blood into the flock.
Stocked up the larder in preparation for a long winter.
Looks like we might actually have something to eat this winter.
And planted high-value crops.
Here he goes.
Oh, it's quite exciting, really.
Come on, walk on.
Now it's November, and if the team are to prosper as Edwardian farmers, they'll have to turn to the latest farming practices of the age.
Loud! Really loud!
Get to grips with the technologies of the time.
It's almost like a steam engine!
And use Edwardian science to set up an exciting new venture.
You're playing golf without really knowing what golf should be doing.
On the Edwardian farm, the time has come to plough the land. Alex and Peter want to grow oats, essential as feed for their livestock, and potatoes, a reliable source of income.
Good lad.
New technology was on the horizon, but most farmers still relied heavily on horsepower.
Coming into the season where these fellas really earn their keep. Because it's out to the fields, it's working in heavy clay, and this is really what the shire was bred for. It was the heavy draft work.
Come on, boys, let's go.
Let's go.
Shires Tom and Prince have never pulled a plough before.
Come to me.
Walk on.
Come on.
Hey, Tom.
Come on, boys. Come on.
Lifelong ploughman Will Williams has been called in to help them on their way.
That's a nice straight line you've done.
That's marvellous.
I think it's more luck than anything.
You think it's more luck than judgment? I dreamed of having lines this straight so early on in the day, Will.
How long have you been doing it?
Well, I've brought up, really. From childhood.
Right.
Oh.
How old are you now?
I'm 77.
77? Right. It's a fair old time then.
Yep.
The two shires are working together well, but Will is unhappy with the plough.
Not deep enough.
Whoa!
All right.
That's right. It's very important to get that to cut in the right place.
We've noticed we've got a bit of a problem here. Whilst our sheep have been out here and eating this down, we've still got quite a lot of growth on the field, and that's not a good thing if that's showing, because all that'll do over the winter period and into the spring is that'll grow, and that'll affect whatever seed we put in here. That'll essentially hamper the growth of that seed. So what we're doing here is we're setting the depth of this little accessory here. It's called the skimmer. And what the skimmer will do is it'll go in and it'll cut off the first inch and a half or so. So that'll actually cut that sort of through there, upside down, and roll it right in.
where they come.
Are you happy with
that? Yeah, we'll see how it goes. Well, it's too deep or too narrow.
This is what I really like about ploughing, because we don't really recognise what an art it is.
Every furrow should be like turning over a page in a book.
Right.
Should be lying exactly the same.
Gotta be straight on anything we do.
This is it. This is what makes a farmer. It's an art, it's a skill, it's a science, it's an industry, it's a livelihood, it's a way of life.
But it was a way of life that was rapidly changing. The days of farming with horses were numbered. In 1903, a revolutionary new piece of Edwardian technology hit the marketplace, promising to change the face of farming.
Oh my word. What have we here?
In the age that gave rise to the travelling salesman, tractor enthusiast David White hopes to convince the team to trade in their horses and join the petrol revolution.
Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Morning.
I've come to demonstrate the new Ival agricultural motor to your good selves.
Agricultural motor, yeah?
Furnished with a two-cylinder engine running on petroleum motor spirit. Start and stop at will. It needs no rest. We don't need to change, as you need to change a horse team.
So, let's get this straight. The internal combustion engine has arrived on the agricultural scene with this machine, yeah?
This is the future, sir.
Today, this X-demonstrator model is the oldest working tractor in the world.
And you've brought your ploughman along with you?
Morning.
Hello, Mr. Williams. Now, with a good team of horses,
yep,
I'd say you'd plough an acre of land in 8 hours. This would plough 2 acres in 4 hours.
2 acres in 4 hours.
So it takes a quarter of the time.
Yeah, allows to demonstrate.
Excellent.
What's happening? As we're going this way, we're only ploughing one furrow because the plough is sliding on the bank.
Right, I see.
And then that way, he's getting stuck over there, isn't he?
Oh, it's obviously the ploughman.
So far, it's looking like the Ival will be a tough sell.
Not the prettiest bit of ploughing I've ever seen. Spent all this time trying to lift the soil up to get the air into it, only then to drive machines across it. You know, these are people that have spent their lives working with horses. Their fathers, their grandfathers, you know, we're going back hundreds of years working with animals who can, you know, disperse their weight. Whereas this thing is struggling.
Whoa, this is cool.
Did you notice how he said whoa to the tractor?
I noticed
how you said whoa to the tractor.
Whoa, what fast, isn't it?
It's a relentless form of power.
It is.
It's just pushed, it's using power to push through. And whereas the plowman would be using his frame, his body, to react against the slope to work with it, here, Harry's fueled by levers.
Loud!
Oh.
Really, really loud!
This is the change of the countryside, I suppose, from being quite a peaceful rural idyll, albeit very hard work, being quite a noisy,
industrial sounding sort of place.
Although one thing we don't know about it is the price.
That's true, we haven't had a story.
Let's, before we have a heart attack over the price, let's see what it can do in the barn, because it might redeem itself somewhat.
While the men take the idol up to the barn, Ruth has come to commiserate with Prince.
Yeah, there's no afternoon tractor. Yeah, busily superseding you.
At the beginning of the 20th century, well over a million Shire horses still worked on farms and in industry. But just 50 years later, the Shire faced the very real threat of extinction.
So many people who remember working with horses talk about the joy going out to farming to some extent, and then stopped using the horses, moved over to tractors. I mean, I know the tractors are more powerful, more versatile in many ways. You can see why people moved over to them. But, gosh, something was lost in the process.
In the barn, the team are keen to see if the idol will power an old Edwardian kibbler, a device used to grind down cereal crops into animal feed. Previously requiring the horsepower to drive the machine, the tractor could save the team a huge amount of work.
That's power, Peter! That's serious power!
The dairy is power!
Let's get up. That is seriously far! We come down here, we look at that. This level of power on a farm could save an enormous amount of time. I think really this is where the internal combustion engine is going to come into its own.
Silence.
How was that, gentlemen?
I'm super impressed. I've never seen milled cereal come out of a machine that quickly before. And we've worked with a fair few machines, but that's brilliant, isn't it?
Sounds to me you need an idol agricultural mill.
It's kind of redeemed itself. I remain to be convinced on the ploughing front.
There's a couple of ticks in the plus column.
But the big question is,
I need a competent ploughing operative.
How much?
It's a mere £300.
£300?
So if I was buying that today, 6 years' wages.
6 years' wages.
Wow. I'm sure we could work out easy instalments for your good self. Sign on the dotted line, it could be yours in 40 years' time.
With such a hefty price tag, only 500 idols were sold worldwide.
That's quite a machine, isn't it?
It's quite a machine.
It's going to give us some work though, isn't it?
Yeah, it feels like this.
For Edwardian farmers, new technology would become increasingly important to their survival. Facing stiff competition from abroad for traditional crops, British farmers had to stay one step ahead of the game. The latest scientific knowledge enabled entirely new forms of agriculture to emerge. In 1901, the Tamar Valley became home to one of the country's first fish farms.
This is River Tamar. It is a formidable barrier that runs between Devon, where we are now, and Cornwall over there. In come the Edwardian period,
the mining that happened in the hills around us had polluted this river. It was so bad, you could take a horseshoe, pop it in the water, and a few days later, it was copper plated.
The pollution from mining wiped out fish stocks in the river. So the Tamar's biggest landowner, the Duke of Bedford, turned to Edwardian science to farm fish in an artificial hatchery.
His aim, to breed salmon and trout to restock the river. My aim is setting up a fish hatchery here on our farm to explore that Edwardian science, which is now a multi-million pound industry.
First pioneered in Scotland in the late 19th century, today over a quarter of all fish consumed in the world is farmed. Peter is hoping to rear trout. To understand the science behind it, he's travelled upriver to meet Rodney Hill and 96-year-old Horace Adams, who worked at the hatchery on the Duke of Bedford's Devonshire estate.
So this hatchery was built around, as I say, 1900 to 1910,
area up to it. Horace is one of the few men who has bred fish the Edwardian way.
We had four boxes. Water comes through here, here's the taps, and runs into this box here, and flows through there, onto the next box.
And then the eggs were put into the hatchery. In the old days they used to sit the eggs on glass tubes, singly, and then the latter days they used to put them in big trays.
But once you get them onto the tubes, full stop, you mustn't interfere with them again then.
Right.
You see, unless there's a bad egg, and then you've got to be very, very careful.
How will I know if an egg is dead?
If one starts to go bad, they go white.
Right.
And if you leave them there for over a day, they show a kind of fungus, and that affects the other eggs. So you've got to make sure you get that egg out immediately, otherwise you can destroy the lot.
Right.
Simple as that. And then they start etching out, and they etch out in from 39 to 41 days.
Yes.
There's a little yolk sac, which feeds in for about 14 days.
Yes.
And when that dissolves, you start hand feeding them with the dog's biscuits, liver, rabbits, almond stuff, and different awful stuff, isn't it? In the summer, the blowflies would come in, and you know, you'd have hundreds and hundreds of maggots. It was quite a smelly business. But by God, they go for the maggots, you know.
I bet they can smell you a mile off.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you weren't out home with the same trousers on, sort of thing. You were smelly, quite a thing.
Do you have any confidence in me to build a hatchery?
Well, no, not really.
Well, Horace and Rodney, they've given me a lot of information, but also given me a lot of doubt. These eggs, they're so fragile. If the box gets locked, if it gets too cold, if the water is too flowing through too quickly, we're all going to die. So it'll all come to nothing.
While Peter contemplates the complexities of his new venture, on the farm, Ruth is attempting her own project. Breathing new life into the all-important privy. A facility that in rural areas had changed little.
Although in the Edwardian age, an awful lot of people were moving on, you know, from this sort of privy. Water closets getting really quite common actually in towns. I mean, even really quite modest houses are having water closets installed. But out in the countryside, most Edwardians were still working on privy systems, rather like this.
Rural privies were often found in the same building as the pigsties, so the farm's animal and human waste could be composted together, a system that was no longer viable in the increasingly populated towns and cities.
Towns have to move over to new forms of sanitation as their populations rise. Push people in closer and closer together, you're going to get more and more disease. You've got to find a new way of dealing with it. out here where you've got plenty of fresh air to deal with all the fumes and stuff going off, plenty of space for composting, you can manage a hygienic system without needing the new technology.
To sterilise the privy seat, Ruth uses caustic soda.
And this will kill every last remaining little trace of bug. In the late Victorian and Edwardian period, people are first really getting to grips with what germs are, what bacteria is. The microscopes are revealing all. And as a result, it's sort of provoked a, well, almost a paranoia, really, about germs and bacteria and dirt. So that you find really very, very, very rigorous cleaning regimes.
For the privy walls, Ruth uses a solution made from limestone.
Whitewash, being based on lime, is caustic and alkali, and it kills bugs. It's a sterilising solution, as well as making an area lighter and brighter. So it helps with being able to see in the dim light.
Build his trout hatchery, Peter will need timber, an important industry in the Tamar. To keep pace with the demand for wood, Edwardian foresters process the timber on site using steam-powered portable sawmills. Farmer and sawyer Roy Hebditch runs this now rare saw bench and traction engine.
Do these things travel around different estates?
Yeah, they normally go into an estate and set up. They stay there for a few months, kind of a whole load of timber that lasts in status for, let's say, 4 or 5 years. And you have to remember that moving around costs them money. When they're on the roads, they're not earning anything.
Well, I'll show you how it works if you like.
Yeah, I know.
Come on then.
Power from the engine.
Yes.
Creates a rotation motion through the saw.
And that's driving the saw blade.
That's driving the saw blade direct, right?
Yeah.
The saw speed on this one is about between 420 and 430.
Revolution per minute.
Yeah. Gives you a roughly, a tip speed around 95.
I don't know, no,
that's right on the very tip there.
If you ever got your fingers caught in that, that'd be it, really.
So I think they'll let you
do what I am
the things.
Okay, mate.
Roy's steam-driven traction engine powers both a 4 foot 6 inch blade and a sliding bench.
Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
This enabled the Edwardian sawyer to cut through timber quicker and with greater precision than ever before.
That's 10, 9, 8, 7.
There you go.
6. Right, there you go. Oh, 6. Okay.
This is timber sawing, Edwardian style. None of your hand sawing, none of your physical effort. This thing, it just eats through it. It's all about setting it up and letting it go.
There you go, you're now a sawyer.
Yeah.
There you go. A sawyer. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Don't I know? I've got it. Gets everywhere, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Really does.
On the farm, Ruth has been applying the finishing touches to the newly refurbished privy.
Making toilet paper. So this is a really old tradition. People have been doing it for centuries. In fact, there's even a Shakespearean line talking about some other sort of literature as being fit only for bomb fodder.
Now all the critter needs is some animal dung to compost with a human waste.
These are two.
Yep, these are our two large blacks.
Hey girls.
Farmhand Megan Elliott has brought two sows for the pigsty.
So large blacks, that's a local.
Yeah, in the late 1800s, the large blacks, you know, were the breed of that time. Big,
nice fat pig.
But yeah, they've got these big loppy ears that go over their eyes, and because they can't see so well, that makes them quite placid.
Nice, easy pigs. Good girls. Good girls. Just a bit more now. Come on.
Yeah. That's it.
Come on, Em.
With the sows safely in their new home next to the privy, Ruth and Megan turn their attention to grooming.
Good. We can't go wrong with them, really.
So how often do you reckon we should do this oiling of the pigs then?
Well, it's just when you look at their skin and you think, oh, they need a bit, you know, looking a bit dry, or if they're itching, you know, a fair bit.
Brushing a paraffin-based oil onto the pigs will help to condition their skin and kill parasites.
It's funny actually, because this works on people too. Head lice, I get rid of them by just using any vegetable oil. I just pour vegetable oil on my head and rub it in, leave it for a while and then wash it out. And because they breathe through their skins, the lice, a lot of these little parasites. And so if you can clog their skin up with oil or fat, they can't breathe, they suffocate.
You still enjoy it anyway.
They do seem to like it, don't they? Better groomed than I am.
Peter's been hard at work constructing his trout hatchery.
These sections here, and then the fish jump out here.
He's attempting to replicate the Edwardian design that Horace and Rodney described to him.
So I finally finished my hatchery. The water's going to come in here through a pipe, and it will slowly feed through these holes into these three chambers. This first one is going to have glass rods upon which the eggs will sit. These other two, I'm going to put stones in to mimic the riverbed. The water will flow on the top, keep it all oxygenated, and hopefully we'll have little trout that will jump over here into the final box.
To waterproof the hatchery, Peter uses pitch, which is extracted from the roots of pine trees.
This pitch is amazing stuff. It's actually a liquid. If we were to leave this long enough, it would be a pool on the floor, but that would be an awfully long time.
For the pitch to be used as a paint, it has to be melted down. The same process used to waterproof boats.
It's looking good. Time to get it on the hatchery. As far as I understand, the eggs are very, very fragile. They're very susceptible to vibrations. They're very susceptible to temperatures. They're very susceptible to pretty much anything. I mean, I just really don't see this working, to be honest. But it's worth a shot, isn't it?
Peter has also built a baffle box, a device to filter out sediment from the stream, which could damage the fragile trout eggs.
Touch wood, the water will come through this pipe and end up in my hatchery box over there.
From the baffle box, clean, oxygenated water is siphoned into the hatchery, where Peter's trout eggs will be stored. The idea is to replicate a natural riverbed, but in a controlled environment.
Seems to be working. The water's trickling over, moving, keeping it oxygenated, and it's ready for the eggs. But to get the eggs, I need some fish that are ready to spawn, and I think I've got a stripper, whatever that is.
Thank you.
whilst Peter sets up his hatchery concern, have come up here onto Dartmoor to just get a good look at the Devon landscape, and you'll just see how important the hedgerows are to this landscape. It's almost as if when you look out, there's a patchwork quilt been draped through these valleys. And the reason you would want these hedge banks all over your farm is so that you could manage your stock more profitably. You can stop them from getting into certain fields, hold back the pasture, and ensure that throughout the year you're giving your animals a regular feed. And of course, you also want to keep them off of your crops as well. So these hedgerows are in fact fundamental to the farming industry of the southwest, not just today, but back in the Edwardian period and beyond.
Over the winter months, it was vital for farmers to build and maintain their hedgerows, a craft that Alex is keen to learn. But first, he will need the right cutting tool for the job, a Devon billhook. He's come to see Roger Bonney at the Finch Foundry on Dartmoor.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for having me over.
It's a pleasure.
So, I've come here to see if we can get a traditional Devonshire-style billhook made up.
Yeah, we've certainly come to the right place. Here's Simon, one of our smiths.
Hello, Simon.
Hello. He's the chap that'll make the tool that you require.
We're just basically getting it roughly there, but we're not going to forge it right out yet because it's going to be quite thin.
Right.
Okay, ready to go and fire.
Right, back in again.
Tool making had long been the job of a local village blacksmith, but by the Edwardian age, larger, state-of-the-art forges began to take over. At the Finch Foundry, blacksmiths manufactured over 400 tools a day.
They made a whole range of stuff, and we've got a catalogue, actually.
This is from our period, this?
Yes.
Oh, fantastic.
And you can see them. Yeah. They make tools for every occasion here. Yeah.
All sorts of things here.
Selection of shovels, different patterns. You'll notice there's a Cornish shovel and there's a Devon shovel. Slightly smaller. So we've got a Cornish shovel and a Devon shovel. They're the bigger lads now in Cornwall. We can't agree on anything either side of the table. So two different patterns.
But this isn't just a cottage industry, is it?
It's gone up a gear, up a step. This is no longer what perhaps a lot of us remember as the village forge or the smithy. Yeah. This is mass production.
Yeah.
The forge uses water power technology to drive heavy hammers and pump air into its fires.
Oh, now this is the water wheel here which drives the fan.
Right,
we're going to open this one up using this lever here. That wheel drives through a lot of gearing inside the building here, a fan, and that fan was used to replace the original bellows.
Right. The good news for me today is that I'm not going to be spending the whole
You're
day.
You're not going to be spending the whole day pumping bellows.
Water and gravity is going to be doing that for me.
That's right.
Fantastic.
The water-powered machine blows air into the hearth, bringing the fire up to a temperature of 1500 degrees centigrade, hot enough to soften iron and steel.
What are we actually starting with the raw material?
So what we've got here is a piece of wrought iron. Right. This normally came in big bars known as pigs.
Pigs.
Okay. Small piece, piglet.
Piglet, right.
Okay. But what we do with this, we hammer this out, and we finish up with something like this. Two pieces of wrought iron, and running right down through the middle, a bit like the filling in a sandwich, is a piece of what's known as shear steel.
Shear steel.
Yeah.
Right.
Now that is a version of hardened metal. And then once it's ground, that hard steel edge is exposed.
Comes through the middle.
That's right.
So you start off with the sandwich like so, and it grinds it down like that, and it comes to the point.
And it comes to the point.
And that's your cutting edge.
And that was the secret of the success of this business.
Ah, I see. The mysterious art of the blacksmith. Yeah.
We're thinning the blade edge now, so...
Right.
I'm trying to keep it straight and maintain that shape. Just follow me. If it goes slow, you go slow.
After constructing his trout hatchery, Peter now needs fertilised eggs.
These guys are ready to spawn, aren't they?
These fish are ready to spawn.
He's come to see fish farmer Trevor Wyatt, who's netted some female brown trout.
Beautiful fish with lovely red spots down the flank.
Trevor plans to remove the unfertilised eggs from the trout, which she would normally lay on the riverbed.
So how can you tell them they're ready?
Well, they're quite swollen and soft on the belly there. She's full of eggs.
Right.
So if you would hold the bone for me.
Removing the eggs from the trout involves a delicate and harmless process known as striffing.
She's ready to spawn now.
Oh, blimey. I mean, these are just the eggs coming out of it.
These are the wonderful eggs. So gently stroke the eggs towards the vent, and then come out into the bowl quite naturally.
Wow, that's a lot of eggs.
It's an awful lot of eggs.
How many eggs are we looking at here?
This fish is about 2 pounds, and therefore should give us about 1,500 to 1,600 eggs.
That's a lot of eggs.
It's a lot of eggs.
And this, it doesn't hurt the fish at all.
It doesn't harm them at all, as long as we're careful not to squeeze too tight.
Yeah.
Then the fish are perfectly okay.
Right.
And eventually we'll see where the stomach is completely collapsed, all the eggs are out, and we can release the fish back into the river.
She's going
back to where she came from.
So we've got the female eggs in the bowl.
Yes.
And we're now adding the male, just the milk.
The milk, yes.
Right.
I suppose trout sperm.
Trout sperm is exactly what it is.
In the wild, a male trout would release his sperm onto the eggs lying in the riverbed.
Gently stir them out into the eggs. So from that moment onwards, young fish are starting to develop. First cell divisions are taking place.
By doing the hatchery, I suppose you've got slightly more control.
We have a lot more control, and in actual fact, we can get 80% or even more of these eggs to be properly fertilised.
Wow.
Where in the wild, maybe only 2 or 3% would be fertilised. So, I mean, in this way, if we manage to enhance the number of fish in the stream, then the stream can be restored to its former glory.
Just clean it up.
At the forge, Alex's Devon billhook is taking shape.
Right, now we need to take some material down quite rapidly.
Right.
Just to speed things up. We can take that down with the trippet hammers.
So we have the technology here with the trip hammers, and these are the very last surviving authentic trip hammers, which with a little bit of luck we can still see working.
The 3/4-ton hammer is powered by its own water wheel.
Wow, that's quite some engineering, isn't it?
It is. Made in Tavistock, right. The largest of our water wheels. It fuses something like about 12.5 horsepower.
Oh right, okay. So that's pretty, when you think of the size of a shy horse, 12.5
shy horse. Yeah.
That's really something, that is.
And of course you don't have to feed this.
No.
This is all free.
It feeds itself.
It feeds itself. All we need is the water.
Yeah.
And we've got plenty of that.
Plenty of that in this part of the world.
Yes.
Well, I suppose you better see it in motion. I'll give you a shout. I'll stand back.
Yes, please do. You'll get wet otherwise.
So here we go. Time to see the biggest wheel working. Okay, Roger, we're ready! So this is the moment then when Quincy's boundary comes to life.
Helps to flatten out the billhook, saving the blacksmith valuable time and effort.
What you saw was just a fraction of what it would have been.
Like,
so in our heyday, in mass production, this hammer would have been really hammering. Right. It would have actually been striking at 240 beats a minute.
240 beats a minute.
Pretty much a blur. That one's 3/4 of a ton.
3/4 of a ton.
This one,
that bad boy,
is 1.25 tons. We daren't use this one. This would shake the whole building apart. This was used to make pipes, to make blades for shovels.
Right, oh, so you're really smacking down to get really thin.
That's right. You couldn't buy plate ready-made. You've got to make your own from that same raw material.
Right.
Do you remember?
Yeah.
The pig.
So you've got the pig there.
We're hammering that out.
Yeah.
To make a sheet.
Yep.
And we end up with something a bit like this.
Oh, fantastic.
That forms the basic shape of, in this case, a Devon shovel. They are responsible for forming the Devon landscape, really. They're that kind of odd shape, because by and large, down here in the West Country, there's so much stone in the ground
that
the traditional garden spade is totally useless.
Right, just a general clean-up now.
In the foundry's heyday, a blacksmith could make a billhook from scratch in half an hour.
Give it a good brush up, and probably we'll run the rasp over just to take any rough edges.
You're going to pay the man.
I'm going to pay you, I want to pay you.
Number seven.
Number seven. 12 shillings.
A dozen.
A dozen.
Yeah.
Shilling a piece.
Yes, that's what, 5p each.
You've made yourself 5p today, Simon.
Well, you know what I'm going to do with that?
Don't spend it all on beer.
I'll get a few pints for that.
Buy yourself a sip of cider.
So if you flip it over again for me.
There we are. There it is, my authentic Devonshire billhook. That's fantastic, all hand forged.
All with water power.
All with water power as well. You couldn't get more authentic than that, I don't think.
I hope that gives you many years of good service.
He does it. This is your new home. It's taken ages to build this hatchery. I hope you like it.
Yes, it looks very nice.
Well, thank you for saying that. Nice. I pop you in here.
Peter must get his fertilised trout eggs into the fresh, oxygenated water of his hatchery as quickly as possible before they begin to die.
All these eggs have a tiny little black dot in the centre of them. So I'm hoping these little black dots are natural. I'm hoping that's just the nucleus of the egg. And I'm going to lay these very carefully onto the glass rods. Ooh. Easier said than done. The idea of the glass rods, it will help us identify the bad eggs, and then we can periodically get rid of them because they turn white, they grow spores, and those spores affect the other eggs. A bit like apples in a barrel. That's a bad one there. It's gone white. Ooh. Just starting to go bad. It's very, very fiddly, but I can see the merits of the system. It's really a sort of man conquering his environment, isn't it? Thank God the fish. Right, now that we've got, well, a number of eggs on the glass rods, it's time to put them into the water. Just hope at the end of all this, we get at least one trout.
It's late November, and the long winter evenings have set in.
Now that you're Devon's very own fish baron, I'd like to introduce you to my new tool.
Ruth has borrowed an Edwardian gramophone, an innovation in home entertainment that was rapidly gaining in popularity.
Oh, popular culture at our fingertips.
Let's call it culture. I'll reserve
some. 15 years of age today, and I think you'll admit, I don't know much about things, but I know a little bit.
For those who could afford it, the gramophone brought the sounds of London's music hall stars to a wider audience for the first time.
So who is this?
Oh, this is the famous Billy Williams. Surely you've heard of Billy Williams. He was this really great music hall star of the time. And he's thought to be one of the most prolific makers of records, most prolifically recorded artists, maybe even of all time, certainly of his own time.
Wow, didn't know he was such an expert.
It's funny though, as well, to think that those tunes are going to get whistled around lanes all over the place.
Mm.
You might hear the same tune being whistled here as you would in the Highlands of Scotland.
Mm. Yeah.
I'll be glad, and I'll be stopping at the office very late, just like
the
dear old
dad. I can't work out whether this is slutty or not.
Just on the edge.
It's a slightly misguided.
It is, isn't it? A touch of innuendo in there.
Armed with his brand new Devon Bill book, Alex is ready to take on the farm's unmanaged hedgerows.
This is exactly the problem that we're having here on the farm. This hedge and this hedge bank simply hasn't been maintained properly. And as a consequence, we're getting vast gaps here, which are sheep tired of this field. They're running off into pastures that we actually want to use later in the winter. And the reason this isn't working as a stock-proof barrier is simply because it isn't being laid properly, or pleached, as they say, in this part of the world. And it's a skill that we are rapidly losing, so I'm desperate to try my hand at it to see if I can hedge as good as the next man. And with my new billhook, I'm hoping I shouldn't have any problems.
To teach him this ancient rural craft, hedge layers from the Blackdown Hills Hedge Association have arrived on the farm.
Thanks ever so much for coming down.
And they've brought their own selection of billhooks for the job.
That's a typical Devon. Some of them had more of a hook on, like a Kentington pattern.
A Kentington? That's
Kentington.
Right, obviously quite similar to that one, isn't it?
This is from Yorkshire.
Yorkshire?
So it's a big...
That's a big old beast, isn't
so
it?
So for a lot more two-handed, you can use it two-handed as well as single-handed.
Right, okay.
And it has a thin blade.
Yep.
So you can get in where you can't get an axe in, between stems.
Right, oh I see. That gives you an idea then of the kind of variation you're getting throughout the country in the different styles of billhook.
You just cut it down in the direction you want it to go. So if you wanted to go straight up through, you put it 90 degrees that way.
The head. George has been laying Devon hedges since he was a boy.
Yeah, I've been doing it 45 years and I'm still learning. You never learn on this. Every hedge is different.
Once any excess or dead foliage has been removed from the hedge, the bare stems, or pleaches as they're known, are laid flat.
Still actually attached to the base, you can see this bit of barkwood in here. That's allowing the goodness that the roots are collecting from the soil to travel up this part of the plant and along the horizontal.
Once the pleature is down, all the dormant buds that are along there, they'll get the sunlight, so that's where they will grow up from.
One, two, three, all very evenly spaced.
Yeah.
And what you're saying is they're going to chase the light,
exactly.
They're going to look for the light, and that's going to create our stop-proof boundary. Is that the idea?
Yeah. One thing I'm already picking up on is the fact that this isn't as simple as it looks, actually, just a case of laying
all the various decisions you happen to make as you're working with the hedge. Trying to decide what you're going to lay, how you're going to use it, what you're going to take out, how you're going to use different species. It's actually quite a lot to learn, so just have to keep my wits about me today and listen out, and hopefully I'll be able to pick up some of the tricks of the trade.
A well-maintained hedge acts not only as a stock-proof boundary, but as a habitat for wildlife, where fruit can thrive. Ruth is taking advantage of a rare spell of November sunshine to forage for sloes.
Sloes are pretty much the last of the autumn hedgerow fruit. So when everything else is finished and bare, you come out for your sloes. So we're all starting to realise again now, you know, just how important to resource these sorts of scrappy bits of hedge line are. And one of the joys of British countryside. You get this lovely golden light through everything. It just makes you feel good. Oh, look at those cows. I always love doing this sort of picking of free food. It's a really good excuse to be out. Of course, the health advice for Edwardian women was to be out and about walking as much as possible. I'm forever saying that the woman who walks out of the fresh air regularly every day in a vigorous fashion is the one who has no problem with her monthly cycle, is the one who has babies nice and easily, is the one who remains in cheerful spirits. It's supposed to be really good for you. And for some reason, women seem to need walking more than blokes. I don't know why.
Ruth is going to use the fruit to make slow gin.
And when the boys say, "So what have you been doing all day?" Nobody's going to argue with me, and I'll say I've been making gin.
For Peter, the trout hatchery is becoming a full-time job. He's checking on it twice a day.
All these leaves are getting swept down and they're clogging up these pipes. I'm trying my hardest with chicken wire just to keep the pipe open and the flow of water into the hatchery continuous. ancient, everlasting battle. There we go. Got it.
Leaves are clogging up the baffle box, which is supposed to filter out sediment from the stream, keeping the hatchery and its fragile eggs clean.
Everything is covered in sediment. They all look pretty white to you. That is properly white. That is the dead end. Every single day. They're quite warm though. The boots are quite waterproof. They trap the water when it gets heated up. It's nice. Oh, that one delusional. Me.
Oh, it smells good.
Ruth is making slow gin for Christmas, a practice that many Edwardians would have frowned upon.
I'm being really wicked here. I'm being bad. The Edwardian period is the absolute height of the temperance movement in Britain. The Band of Hope, people signing the pledge, refusing to take any more alcohol. And great huge campaigns led by the church, all of which were very, very, very anti-alcohol. So how many have I got in there? Oh, so I want it sort of up to about there. Just prick all the flows. I'm using a knitting needle because not so pointy on the fingers as using a pin. And you just fill the bottle up. And then you add some gin and sugar. Just as much or as little as you like, really. I'm so bad. Right. Cork. Shove it in. And slowly, slowly, over the next couple of weeks, all the juices from the berries will colour the gin and it'll go dark purple. Then, come Christmas, it'll be absolutely delicious. Don't tell the neighbours.
Stop the sheep from getting noses up there.
Put them in a little bit of an angle.
There's so much to remember here.
Look, do you want me to write it out on a bit of paper?
Yes, you could.
Alex and his team have laid a length of new hedge, known in the industry as a chain. This is 22 yards, what a single hedge layer would deem to be a satisfactory day's work.
Yeah, you've done some very good cuts.
You please, yeah.
Cool.
And here we are,
gents. Hello, chaps.
Hello.
Wow, this looks good, doesn't it? So you're going to be renovating the entire Ruddy farm now, are you?
It takes a while. Think it's cider time. Cheers. Cheers to a fantastic day's hedging.
Long may the hedge live.
Long may the hedge live, yeah.
This is a bit moorish, isn't it?
That's very nice, I'd say.
It's been 41 days since Peter introduced the fertilised eggs to his hatchery. The trout should now be hatching.
Let's see how they're doing.
Quite a few dead eggs there.
I have to say, I mean, it's a real insight into the effort that went into a new enterprise. Because this has been a real struggle. You're playing God without really knowing what God should be doing, if that makes sense. There's so much silt coming through here. Well, this one's silting up a lot.
an awful lot.
Oh! Look!
Just down here.
Yeah, I mean, you know, waxing lyrical about, ooh, it might fail. That, if I'm not very much mistaken, are trout, and they're moving, and they've got the little sack, they have hatched. We've got at least three. At least three. That is absolutely incredible. They've got the egg sac, which is currently feeding them, but once they've finished eating that, a bit like a tadpole, they then have to find their own food. And that's when I'm going to have to build them a new tank, and that's when I'm going to have to start grinding up rabbit, and then we feed them into trout. I think we have fought with one. We have trout. We've succeeded in our new enterprise.